morning once again. Good morning once again. Welcome to Praise Life. We all join together in singing and praising our God. And may His name be glorified as we raise our voices and sing. I want to welcome each one of you. The first song that we're going to sing is called I Sing Praises to Your Name. And He has to be exalted, right? Let's all join and sing this second song. He is exalted forever, exalted on high.
Thank you.
morning, one and all. I want to welcome each one of you on this Sabbath afternoon. So I should be able to wish you all a good afternoon, right? Once again, I take this opportunity to welcome you from the HopeSide Community Adventist Church for this divine hour. And I know the Lord, in His own infinite mercy, has been so much blessed each one of us to be a part of Him. And the whole week was so great. In spite of all the ups and downs, He has given us an opportunity, a day of rest and gladness, where we could rest upon the shoulders of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to enjoy the blessing, listen to His word. So people who are watching online, either it might be Zoom or YouTube, please feel at home. I know that this message where Dr. Suhana is going to bring to each one of us from the throne of grace will uphold each one to be a part of Him. So I want to thank each one of you for joining with us on this divine hour. Before we could be able to begin, I do have few announcements to be made. I want you to please pay close attention towards it. And of course, we are in the second week of the month, which is focused on health matters. Here's the quote to reflect on the theme. Self-care is how you take your power back. Self-care is how you take your power back. Most probably it was quoted from healthyplace.com. Of course, the very first week of prayer will be from July 18 to 23. And of course, we are going to end up on July 24th with the divine service. And we do have Dr. Varaprasad Dipati, Dr. Jason Israel, and Dr. Sharad Babu who will be leading in this week of prayer. And you can be able to join us either in Zoom or YouTube. Please to continue to pray for these meetings. May the Lord be able to use the speakers and that moment to glorify His name and draw many more souls to His kingdom. And of course, we do have prophecy live on every Saturday at 3 p.m. and Sunday at 9 a.m. Please do remember this lay ministry. And if you'll be able to join it, you'll be really being blessed by prophecy live on every Saturday and Sunday. We do have the midweek prayer meetings on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. And of course, we do start our Whispers meeting on Friday, 8 p.m. So you can be able to join us by Zoom or YouTube too. Women's Bible study is on every Saturday at 3 p.m. EST by Zoom only, organized by Mrs. Pravila Pedapuri. So all are welcome for the lunch and fellowship after the divine hour. So these are the few announcements that I had to make. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. When we are in His holy temple, let all the earth keep silence. May the good Lord help each one of us as we contemplate on His word. May His blessings be poured upon each one of our lives as we listen to His word. Once again, I want to welcome each one of you in the name of Jesus. To begin with, let's all join and sing this beautiful song from SDA Hymn 469, I Surrender All. I Surrender All will be our opening hymn.
I'm
It's time to seek the Lord in prayer. Does anyone has any prayer requests? You can message us. We'll be very happy to join in and do pray for the prayer requests. But we do continue to pray for the few requests that we have on a daily basis. Number one, we do have want to pray for Brother Bob Benjamin, who has been in the hospital, and I think so he's getting well. May the good Lord bless him, recuperate, and he'll be back again to be as a living testimony. We want to pray for the baby Daniel, who is 4 months old, who is going through chemotherapy and radiation for eye cancer. So please to make sure that each one of us who have been watching online, please remember this baby Daniel. The good Lord might be able to enable and been able to be strengthened by each one of our prayers for this lovely family. And of course, we do want to pray for Brother Mervyn Singh, and who is suffering from cancer. He's also going through treatment, and hope the Lord of Heaven will be able to heal him too. And of course, we want to pray for Sister Mary, who is suffering from cancer, and hope the Lord of Heaven will be able to get her back. I don't know about the person who was very much critically ill, Sister Pansy. I'm not so much sure. Brother Subhanallah's wife, how they're doing. We will continue to pray for Mrs. Subhanallah in this regard. And of course, we want to pray for the week of prayer. And we want to pray for all our church members. And some of them are not here, so we want to pray that good Lord will be able to take care of them. And hopefully we could be able to meet again. And these are the few requests that I have. Does anyone has any prayer requests? If not, let's reverently kneel down if possible and seek the Lord in prayer. Our gracious, loving and living Heavenly Father, we praise you, we honor you, we glorify your name for another Sabbath where we could join ourselves in worshiping you. You have led us thus far marvelously, miraculously. Your mighty hands have enstrounded us. O Lord of Heaven, any sins that we committed against you, will you please to forgive us. Accept us as we are. Answer this little prayer. May your name be glorified. Especially we want to pray for Brother Babu Benjamin in a special way. O Lord, thank you for showing mercy. May he be healed by your grace. Continue to be with baby Daniel, who is suffering from eye cancer in this stage. There's no words that we have to express, oh Father. We sympathize with the family. But you are great. Your mercy have endured. You have given them the gift. And may that gift, oh Father, be able to make them happy. Give one more chance for the baby's life, so that, O Father, the faith of the parents might be increased. May your name be glorified. I want to pray for Brother Mervyn Singh in a special way. Your name pierced hand have touched him, O Father. May he be healed completely. Be as a living testimony in these last days. I do want to pray for Sister Mary, who is suffering from cancer. Hope the Lord of Heaven will have mercy and may thine will be done, so that, O Father, she might be able to come into life, able to serve you. I do want to pray for Mrs. Subhanallah, who was in critical condition. We don't know how she is. I know that the Lord of Heaven will be there with her and her family members. Yes, Lord of Heaven, there are many people who have been striving and struggling and suffering because of this pandemic and all the other natural disasters. Be closer with those lovely family members. Give them hope, peace that passes all understanding. I want to pray for HopeSide Church and every individual who have been part of this. Oh Lord, you have chosen us to be a part of you. Use us mightily in this last day so that we could be as a living testimony, bringing many more souls to your kingdom. Especially, O Father, I want to pray for the week of prayer which is going to be held from next week, O Father. be with the speakers, anoint them with your spirit. May that meeting, oh Father, be much more meaningful and draw each one of us to the throne of grace. May our spiritual life be enhanced. May that period of time give us the sense that we could be always been willing to be a part of you. And in these last days, we could serve you to the best of our ability. Without which of your help, it would be impossible that we could do anything. Yes, Lord of heaven, may your mercy endure in our lives as we partake during the week of prayer. Yes, Lord of heaven, at this time, I want to pray for the sick and the suffering and the poor and the needy, the fatherless, the motherless, the destitutes, the orphans and the people who are in need of you. May the worthy hand enshroud them. Especially, I want to pray for Dr. Suhana in a special way. You have chosen her to be a part of us, to speak, O Father, your word. May her words of her mouth and the meditation of her heart be acceptable in your sight. May your gracious hands anoint her with your spirit, so that we all might be richly blessed by listening to your word. I want to pray for many people who are worshipping you today, wherever they might be, O Father. May you continue to be with them. May their prayers be answered. May they be also be blessed. Continue to be with the speakers, wherever they might be speaking on this Sabbath hour. Anoint them with your spirit. As we submit ourselves to you, may the worthy hands lead us the rest of the Sabbath. May we experience your joy, peace and happiness in our lives. And certainly, O Father, we could be able to go out of this hall of worship with a consecrated heart. Continue to help us to grow in your vineyard. Thank you for being with us and answering our prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. At this time, the offering will be collected, and we just have a word of prayer before the offering will be collected. Gracious God in heaven, we thank you. You have given everything for us. Nothing that we have to offer, but we give a heart and mind and soul. Any offering which has been given, O Father, may it be used to glorify your name. Your message might be carried through. And certainly, O Father, many more souls might have an opportunity to see Jesus. Thank you for being with us and answering our prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. For our scriptural meditation, let's turn our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13 and 14. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13 and 14. The Bible says, "For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north." Verse 14, it says, "I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." May God bless the portion of the scriptures just been read for the theme song. Let's all join in and sing this beautiful song, "I Love You, Lord." The fruit of I. The fruit of I. And that is the topic chosen by Dr. Suhana for our devotion this morning. Dr. Suhana Chikatla was born and raised in India. She completed a bachelor's in computer science from Spicer Adventist University and a master's in secondary education from Andrews University. Oh, she has another added master's in sociology from Tilak Vidyapeeth. In 2001, she got a scholarship to do her PhD in the field of instructional design and development at the University of South Alabama. And she worked for 10 years at the University of South Alabama, followed by 6 years at Wallace State Community College and 3 years at Auburn University, Montgomery, and a year at University of Alabama at Birmingham. She has always been very active in our church, and she has been a youth leader and a children's Sabbath school teacher for 20 long years. She has also been in the executive member at the local conference women's ministry, and currently she is the director of our church's Adventurer Club, children's Sabbath school leader and children's ministry leader. Dr. Chikatla is married to Elder Royce Sutton from the Caribbean islands of Antigua and Barbuda, and they together have a daughter, Rihanna. And of course, I know Dr. Suhana when I was studying at Spicer Adventist University, and she always used to be a very jovial person, if I can remember very well. Yeah, very jovial. And they had a good lot of friends, always very jovial people, and their father was a very kind man. And he loved my family, my sisters and myself, always invited home to be a part, of them. And very happy that Dr. Suhana is there with us. May God richly bless you and your lovely family and the ministry that you have been able to do in the place where you are and God has chosen you. HopeSide Church is very happy to have you and listen to God's word through you. And the time is now, Dr. Suhana.
Thank you, Jeffrey. We all love you all. It was always nice to have students on campus, especially talented students like you. And we really enjoyed your music, your sisters singing, all the talent that you all brought to the table. It was really amazing. And thank you. And you keep sharing God's love, wherever you go. And that's amazing. Praise God and honor His name every day for all your hard work. The fruit of I. Happy Sabbath, everybody. So the fruit of I. Initially, my topic, I called it Win One, but I really wanted something that could make more sense. So I picked fruit of I. I used to write sermons for young adults when I was in Mobile, Alabama. Whenever we had programs, I would write their sermons, their skits. And I had forgotten that we did this awesome skit. And one of my friends texted me recently, and she's like, "You remember you used to do these things? I have your script, and I've extended it to me. Let me look at it." And I was surprised that we had done this long time ago, and I had forgotten about it. My computer had crashed, and I had lost all my material. And all these friends that have held on to paper copies, and they send it to me, and it's just amazing how things just come together. And I'm so glad the sermon came together after I saw that script. So the fruit of I, let's look at what the fruit of I is. A scripture reading, it said, "You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the Mount of Assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High." Isaiah 14:13-14. Who is it talking about? Anybody? Let's read a little bit above those passages, and maybe it'll give us a little understanding of who it is talking about. how you have fallen from heaven. Who fell from heaven? The morning star, son of the dawn. And who had that name, morning star? Lucifer had that name. You have been cast down to the earth. You who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the holy most high. But you are brought down to the realm of the dead, to the depths of the pit. So Satan was entitled to die because he thought about I. He was talking about himself. He wanted to be the greatest. There is a joke about a new convert. He was a drunkard and he told his pastor, Pastor, I am your convert. And the pastor replied, I know you are my convert because if you were God's convert, you would not have been in the state you are in now. Sometimes we all forget that we are God's convert. We should never be looking at each other to be converts. There was this preacher, Leo Scriven, who came to Spicer to preach. He took the whole week of prayer for us in India. And he was amazing preacher, the best preacher till date. Even when I came to US the first time, you know, I was a student, even though we had scholarship, you know, the scholarship takes like a couple of months before it kicks in. So even though I had not much money left, I went and I bought his whole DVD set. That's how crazy we were. So many of us had gotten baptized and rebaptized just because of what all things that Leo had told us. And it was amazing. All the truths that we had heard all these years, all our lives, just came to life because Leo had all these things to say, all the pictures that he showed and shared. I don't know if Jeffrey remembers him, but it was just an amazing week. So many people felt blessed and they gave their lives to Jesus. And you know what happened to Leo? Leo, we don't know what problems he was in, but we were told that he used to have mental issues and he committed suicide. Living, being somebody's convert. We need to be in the convert of God. We need to be a convert of God, not each other. Living in the fruit of eyes. Let's look at some of the eyes that people share these days. I do not like to pay my tithe. That's my hard-earned money. You know what 2 Corinthians 9:7 says? God loves a cheerful giver. I don't like to go to church. People have hurt my feelings. But the Bible says, let us go into the house of the Lord. I am stubborn. I lack respect for others. I don't like to help the poor. Matthew 25:40 says, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. And there are so many eyes. I easily am offended or angered. I am divisive. I don't like taking orders. I am ambitious. I like having positions or titles. I don't trust God. I'm anxious of the future. Other ones that we are, I am overly self-conscious and insecure. I know many people who don't come to church because they haven't done their hair. They don't come and do communion because they haven't done their pedicure or done their nails. So many people, I'm often asked them sitting in the church and I'm like, hey, are you not doing foot washing? And they're like, oh, I didn't do my pedicure. So we are so superficial. We need to stop being self-conscious, the eye of self-conscious. I can be jealous and envious and covetous of others. So many times you've heard of people getting jealous of their car, their house, the things that they do. We need to be content with what we have. I'm self-sufficient. I can manage life without God. Many of us think that we can go along this day, every day of our life without God, without praying to Him, without reading His Word. But God always has better hope for us if we are with Him. I like talking about myself and my life. I'm self-serving. I tend to be self-righteous. I feel superior. I think high of self. I desire receiving recognition and credit. I want to impress people. I fear man more than God. Compare myself to others. I'm self-critical. I have a hard time admitting I'm wrong. I hate people who correct me. So many eyes, the fruit of eyes that are just wrong in our lives these days. The fruit of I, the center of sin and pride, is I. Okay. The center of the word Lucifer is I too. The center of lie is I. The center of death is I. The center of partition is I. Satan's biggest sin was pride and lie. Satan's enmity against God began with I. Suffering from the sin of pride, Lucifer lost heaven. He tried to create a partition between angels and God and human beings. His lies made human to have partition with God. You know, Satan grew up in heaven. He had the best education and he refused that education. Sometimes we try to make our churches pure and clean. Sometimes we try to make our environments clean. We try to send our kids to this awesome schools, the best schools. But you know what? Satan had the best school. And what did he do? He left the school. He was a bad apple in that school. And not just that, he took 1/3 of his friends with him when he left that school in heaven, the best heaven. And look at God, Jesus. He grew up in Nazareth. And you know what they said about Nazareth? Nothing good can come out of Nazareth. And what good came out? Jesus came out of Nazareth, the worst. Probably Jesus had experience with all these public students who went to public schools. And there was no hope for these people. But Jesus came out of it. Sometimes we need to quit making our surroundings clean. But make sure our hearts are clean. And then we teach our children to have clean hearts. Because in the end, it's God who's going to lead us. You know, God led Satan in the right path. And he quit listening to God. In heaven itself, in the most purest school, in the most purest environment God could provide, sin erupted. And that's why we have to remember never to try and keep pointing fingers at each other and saying, I do this and you need to do that too. No, let God work in everybody's heart. Okay? I separates us from him. Okay, remember that I, that we always tend to have for ourselves, it'll separate us from him. Let's look at Lucifer, okay? What God has to say about Lucifer. Before God created the earth, he created angels. So he created Lucifer. The Hebrew word for angel is malak, which means messenger. Angels are more powerful than people because God made them higher. People do not become angels when they die. As some books and movies suggest, angels are separate creatures from people. The Bible tells us that there are countless number of angels. The angels served and obeyed God and gave him worship he deserved. Nehemiah 9:6 talks about all these angels that are surrounding God. Okay, there are different types of angels that serve God in different ways. Angels are spirit, but at times they can be seen and heard. Like man, God created angels with mind, emotion, and will. They are free to choose what they want to do. Okay? So angels are just separate beings. They are not human beings. Lucifer means light bearer, shining one, a morning star. The Bible tells us Lucifer was the most powerful angel. Okay? The Bible also describes him in Ezekiel. You are the model of perfection. You were full of wisdom. You were perfect and beautiful. So Lucifer was made perfect and beautiful. God had given Lucifer a very important job. And God said, I appoint you to be like a guardian cherubim. Anoint you for that purpose. You were on my holy mountain. You walked among the gleaming jewels. Your conduct was without blame from the day you were created. But soon you began to sin. You thought you were handsome. and that you were made, and that made your heart proud. You thought you were so glorious that it spoiled your wisdom. So I threw you to earth. So God had to throw him because of his pride, the eye. Some of the names of Lucifer, let's look. Devil means slanderer or liar. Satan, he's an adversary or enemy. Okay, demon, Satan and his angels live to trap men in sin and darkness. So he is known to be as a demon. Okay, the spiritual battle that Satan wages against mankind, the great controversy, the battle between good and evil is brought about by these demons. God had a plan that he's going to destroy Satan one day. And Satan did try to stop that plan, but it didn't happen. But God's plan cannot be stopped. Satan and his angels will definitely be punished one day, okay? So the fruit of I, the good fruit of I, is when you win souls for Jesus. The center of win is I. The center of unity is I. The center of unite is I. We all need to unite with God and win souls. And when we unite people towards God, we get the Holy Spirit in us. Jesus sent Holy Spirit to all the disciples on the day of Pentecost. We all need to win. When we are ready to win souls for Jesus, and when we unite for Jesus, good things happen. We need to strive for the good eye, not the bad fruit of eye. Okay? When in unity, I unite others for him. Okay? Let's look at one of the ancient proverbs. Relationship never dies a natural death. They are murdered by ego, attitude, intolerance, and ignorance. I have seen too many times families being torn apart over things, silly things like politics, religion, just their point of view, intolerance. People are just intolerant about so many things. One lady, we had a movie night scheduled. I was on the executive committee for women's ministry, and we had scheduled a movie night for everybody. At the conference, you know, where people came from different states and different churches to our campground. And you know what happened? The lady came up to her and said, "What kind of movie is this? We don't watch movies, we are Adventists." And I told her, "It's a Christian movie." And she said she doesn't watch movie. She only watches songs and children's stories, but then she does watch it on Sabbath too. I asked her, "When do you watch it?" She said, "Sabbath too." I said, "Look, my TV doesn't even come on Sabbath." You know, every house has their own way of celebrating Sabbath. People don't have to be looking at each other and trying to point fingers and put them down. We just need to be examples to others instead of putting each other down and being intolerant to people. Let's look at what kills our relationship with man. There are a couple of AEIOUs that research or survey has shown. The first one is actions, our bad attitude, lack of apology, ego, lie, pride, sin, overestimating, obedience, underestimating, and unobedience. Okay, let's look at all of them in detail. And also apply it to our relationship with God. An ancient proverb about action, A for action. Be careful of your action. It will reflect you as a whole. You are what you say and do. Okay, I want you to, if you understand Hindi, I want you to watch it. And I'm going to definitely translate this for you. Okay, there's a short video that I want you to watch.
जिंदगी की कमाई पैसे नहीं है ट्रॉफीज नहीं है गाड़ियां नहीं है ज्वेलरी भी नहीं जिंदगी की कमाई है वो बातें वो बोल जो दूसरे इंसान के साथ रह जाता है उसकी जो दुनिया से चला गई मैंने अपने बहुत अजीज बेस्ट फ्रेंड को खोया है वो मुझसे जो कहा करते थे वही उनकी जिंदगी थी। इस तरह ना कमाओ कि पाप हो जाए, इस तरह ना खर्च करो कि कर्ज हो जाए, इस तरह ना खाओ कि मर्ज हो जाए, इस तरह ना बोलो कि कलेश हो जाए, इस तरह ना सोचो कि चिंता हो जाए। सेवा जितनी करनी है कर लो, ऐसा ना हो कि देर हो जाए। उनकी ये बातें फ्रेम कराऊंगी, उनकी जिंदगी जीने की कोशिश करूंगी। शायद वही एक तरीका है कि मैं भी कम उस कर अपनी एक बहुत प्यारी दोस्त को पाया मैंने, वो दोस्त जिससे जिंदगी के इतने सारे पल शेयर किए कि वो यादें मेरी एक जिंदगी के लिए काफी है। और वैसे भी हम दोनों एक दूसरे से कहा करते थे, आना जाना तो लगा रहेगा, जब तू घर से चली जाती है तो फिर कुछ वक्त बाद मैं तेरे घर आ जाती हूँ। तो वो इस दुनिया से चली गई है, मगर हम वहां तो मिलेंगे, पक्की बात है। गला मेरा टाइट है फिर से, लेकिन ये गाना तो गाना ही है। मजरूह सुल्तान को इस आपको बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया कि बस जाते जाते सिखा गए कि जिंदगी में क्या करना है, और बस यही करना है। क्योंकि अनहोनी पग में काटे लाख बिछाए, होनी तो फिर भी बिछड़ा यार मिलाए, ये बिरहा ये दूरी दो पल की मजबूरी, फिर कोई दिल वाला गाए तो घबराए। तरम पम धारा तो बहती है, बहके रहती है, बहती धारा पंचम इस दुनिया से डोल लिख जाएगा, माटी के मोल जग में रह जाएंगे प्यारे तेरे को।
ओके, so let's translate it for our friends who don't get it. She said, life is such where don't earn so much that it can cause you to sin or deceive somebody or fraud somebody. Don't spend so much that you face debt. Don't eat so much that you become a patient. Don't talk so much that you may cause an unpardonable sin. Don't think so much that you may worry about something, but instead sow as much as you can so you don't feel it was too late. And she sang the song, ek din jayega maati ke mol jag mein reh jayenge pyare tere bol, means one day you will be sold for the price of dirt. What is the price of dirt? When we die, we go back to dirt, and the only things left behind will be your words and actions. We have to be so careful what our words and actions can cause, because they live on forever, even when we are gone. Okay, watch our actions. How do you watch our actions? What we think in our mind is so important. What we say, we need to shield ourselves from ungodly attacks. What we hear with our ears, what we see with our eyes, what we do with our hands, where we go to places that we're not supposed to go, things that we may eat or drink, and things that we desire in our hearts, how covetous we are. All these are actions that add up and one day will catch up with us if we are using them to do ungodly attacks on our family, the people that God has given to us. Okay? We need to hold our thoughts and tongues. Mrs. White, in the book of Adventist Homes, section 8, The Successful Family, she says, tongues, ears, and eyes to be sanctified. Let those who composing the family circle pray that God will sanctify their tongues and their ears, their eyes, and every member of their body. When brought into context with evil, it is not necessary to be overcome of evil. Christ had made it possible for the character to be fragrant with good. Okay? Many dishonor Christ and misrepresent his character in the home circle. So we are dishonoring God right here in our homes. Okay, many do not manifest patience, tolerance, forgiveness, and true love in our homes. So it starts in the house. Mrs. White is saying that all these things The calendar is manifested at home. How we act, how we behave, all starts at home. Sometimes it's so easy to get upset with our kids, so easy to be mean to our husbands, you know, and people around our parents. It's so easy with our people, our colleagues. Things that one can say and do can be hurtful. We have to be very careful with our actions, what we do. Okay. Another proverb, a bad attitude is like a flat tire. If you don't change it, you will never go anywhere. I've seen this over and over, friendships breaking up over simple competitions. Who has the nicest car, the newest car? Who has better clothes, the name brand clothes, hairdos? Who went for holidays? Simple things. If somebody goes to the beach, another two people have to go to the beach. If not, they get mad. Who cooks better? Whose food tastes the best? Simple things can make our hearts go wandering towards Satan. And we need to change that bad attitude, because that is like a flat tire. We need to change that tire so we can run smoothly. Okay, I want you to listen to this song that I'm going to play. A couple of years ago when we were at a women's retreat, I was in charge of playing the music. And I played this song. And this lady immediately came running to me and she said, play Sabbath music. This is ungodly music. And I was shocked, because the CD that I played was of this lady who had a very bad past. And I thought everybody knew her song. And that was my mistake, that I didn't know. But you know what she heard? She didn't hear the words. She only heard the drums in that music. And she went berserk. She didn't know how to weed out the noise around her and look at the beauty. You know, we all grew up in India, and there's so much of people practicing Hinduism. People are playing their music to their gods in buses and trains, wherever we go, people are worshiping their gods. I mean, I know some of the prayers too, because I have gone on buses and the man has played that song to their god all night in the bus. And I know those songs by heart, but I have learned to weed out those noises around us. And I have learned to see the beauty in that person. We all need to weed out the noise around us. And I'm going to play that song real quickly for everybody. It is such a beautiful song. And if you can pass not listening to the drums, you will see the words behind that song. So she's talking about being holy, 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 in her pain, in all the things that she went through. The lady that was with me, she may have not gone through that kind of pain. She may have not had that problem in her life, but she chose to correct me. And you know what? The worst part about that day was I was supposed to preach about how older women need to mentor younger women. And she just didn't know about me. She thought I was, you know, because I'm short and some of us Indians don't look our age. She thought probably I was a child running around just putting any music. And when I had the sermon, it was really hard for her. And she didn't come back to that conference again. And it was really hard for me because I didn't have anything against her, you know, but her own mistake had eaten her up. Okay, let's all learn to inspire and boost each other's morale. Share your positivity with other people instead of your negativity. We need to lift each other up every day of our lives, okay? Let's watch this video. It's a lesson from an elephant.
I had many elephants, but one elephant was very powerful, very obedient, very skillful, and the best in the fighting skills. In many wars, he was sent on the battlefield and he would return only after being victorious. He was the most loved elephant of the king out of hundreds and thousands. Time went by and the elephant started getting old. The king did not send him to the battlefield anymore, but he still remained a part of the king's team. Because whenever the king saw him, he felt good, he felt happy. The elephant once went to the lake for a drink. His feet got stuck in the mud there and he started sinking in there. He tried a lot, but he couldn't pull himself out of the mud. People around knew the elephant was in trouble by the sound of his screams. This news also reached the king. There was panic because everybody knew he was the king's favorite. The king reached there and all other people gathered around the elephant and made various efforts to get him out. But there was no way out. It was not a small animal, an elephant. In the meantime, an old retired king's court was passing by. After understanding the situation, he spoke to the king and suggested that the battle drums be played around the lake. The listeners found bizarre. However, as soon as the drums of war started ringing, there was a change in the behavior of the troubled elephant. The elephant slowly stood up and then pulled himself out of the mud on his own. Everybody around was shocked. There wasn't a lack of physical ability on the elephant. Just the need to infuse enthusiasm within was required, and that was done. To maintain enthusiasm in life, it is necessary that humans maintain a purposeful thinking and mindset and do not let despair dominate. Now, why did I tell you all this? In today's challenging times, we all need to enthusiasm in ourselves and the people by being to celebrate abundance of good health, joy, happiness, love. And we have to stop talking about these tough times and how these tough times have been treating us. There is a lot of good happening, guys. We have to see it. And let's be grateful for all that.
Okay. Another proverb. Oh, before I go back. We all need to be able to be positive and share positivity among people. Let's be nice and kind. Our acts of kindness show
our acts of life
in God's life.
In God's life.
God, is that an echo? Sorry. I'm hearing myself somewhere. Okay. Another ancient proverb, ego. It's just a three-letter word which can destroy a big 12-letter word called relationship. Queen Jezebel, Haman had such big egos. They both met their rightful death. We all need to overcome this small word ego and be more realistic about life. Be able to form relationship with people. People who are mean that you think that you don't want to hang out with. Those are the people we need to always go to because they need you. They need Jesus. They need this message that we have from God about his love. We need to share this message with such people. Okay, ego is the only requirement to destroy any relationship. So be the bigger person. Skip the E and let it go. Okay. Skip the E and let it go. Now, what to let, how do we let the E in the ego? So this is how, what happens. There is a continuum. The forces of ego is right here. I am right, where we think our ego, I'm right. If you want it to decrease, you need to be humble. Assume that the other person is right. Other person is right. Reflect on the perspective of probably they are right. Seek truth in prayer. So in prayer, we can get rid of ego. The E in the go and let it go. But if you feed this ego, I am right, you are wrong, I don't care what others think, it just keeps increasing and increasing and increasing. The opposite of pride is humility. We need to become humble. We need to separate, pride separates us from God, and we need to separate ourselves from these kind of thoughts. We need to humble ourselves. Even 2 Kings talks about humility. We need to have a correct view of oneself and correct view of God, and we need to share this view in our life with other people in humbleness. So now, how do we pray? And why do we pray? Isaiah says, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. So we need to pray. This is why we pray, is so that we don't get weary. Because there's so many things going around us, so that we don't get weary of things around us. We pray to stay close to Jesus because he's the only best friend, and we want Jesus in our life. We pray to thank him for his love and care, to ask for forgiveness and to help others and ourselves. Okay. Now, when to pray, you may ask, you know, when Jesus prayed, Jesus says, pray without ceasing. Let's look at some of the Bible verses. God, Jesus prayed in the morning. In Mark 1:35, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus went, got up, left the house and went out in a solitary place. And that's where he prayed. Matthew 14:23, in the evening, after he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone. So he prayed in the evening as well. He prayed all night. Luke 6:12 says, those days, Jesus went out on the mountainside to pray, and he spent the night, the whole night praying to God. So we need to pray without ceasing. When you're walking, you can pray. When you're jogging, you can pray. When you are talking to somebody and you feel that you cannot, you're not going anywhere with this person and this person is being hateful, pray for that person at that moment too. You can pray at all times. Okay. A and I, embrace A in apology and say, I am sorry. When you apologize to a person, that doesn't mean that you're wrong or that the other person is right. It just means that you value this relationship more than your ego. Okay, always let it go. Let it go and just be friends. Unity or partition? What are you feeding? Are you feeding unity or division in your churches? Are you feeding unity or division in your homes? Matthew 10 talks about brothers will turn against their own brothers. So Bible itself tells that brothers, your family, in your family, in your home, things are going to break apart. Okay, fathers will hand over their own children to be killed. Children will fight against their own parents and will have them killed. Everyone will hate you because you follow me. But the one who remains faithful to the end will be saved. When you are treated badly in one city, go to the other city. I promise you that you will not finish going to all cities of Israel before the Son of Man comes again. So God has promised us that we need to be true to God. We need to show his kindness in our hearts to people. We need to sow unity and not division. And God is going to take us far, all the way to heaven when we do that. Unity is strength, but division causes weakness. Okay. Another story is about Admiral Phipps. What did he do? He was in the British Army, and British and French were fighting in Canada in 1750s. Admiral Phipps, the commander of British fleet, was told to anchor outside Quebec. And he was given an order, wait by the British land, you know, wait for the land forces to come to support him. And so when they come is only when he's supposed to attack. But Phelps' navy arrived earlier than the land forces. And then the admiral got tired of waiting. And he started looking around the city from his ship. And he saw these statues of saints around the city that adorned the towers of the cathedral over there. And he got so fed up of waiting. He said, hey, shoot that statue. And eventually he told them, just start shooting. And he made everybody shoot all those statues and knock them all down. But then, you know, what happened when the land forces arrived? He had no ammo left. The admiral was helpless. He couldn't help his people and attack the city. Too many Christians today are like Admiral Phelps. They are so occupied with attacking other saints. They are of no use, only a hindrance to the cause of Christ. We cannot be a hindrance to God. We need to be occupied in doing his work and not causing separation. Okay? Mrs. White clearly warns us against this. She said, there is in some of the members of the church pride, self-sufficiency, stubborn unbelief, and refusing to yield their ideas. This is the message to the Laodicean church, he says. The angels that do the work of separation, I warn the Seventh-day Adventist church to be careful how you receive every new notion and those who claim to have great light. The character of their work seems to be to accuse and to tear down each other. My friends, there are too many around us that can do negative things. Let's all join and do the positive thing. I had a friend who came crying to me one day and she said, Suhana, somebody hurt my feelings. I said, what happened? She said, a lady from her church sent her a video that said that she needs to quit eating meat so that she can have children. She tried to tell her that she was not having kids because she was eating meat. I told her she needs to quit crying at this moment because I have so many friends that eat pork, that drink, that do drugs. They have 7 kids and have healthier babies than some of our own kids. I told her I have friends that are Hindus that have 10 kids. They worship idols and they have 10 kids. I said, just pray to God. All of us have problems in life. We all have our struggles. Everybody in this world faces struggles. Your struggle may be not having kid. Another person's struggle is having a kid who is lost in the world. Other person's struggle is being married and having struggles with their husband. There are so many struggles that everybody faces every day. Let's not be a hindrance to each other. Let's not separate people from God with our mouths, with what we have to say. O's and you, there is more power in unity than division, okay? We should never underestimate or overestimate the power of evil. Division is Satan's number one strategy. And he can separate us from God who created us. You know what he did? He separated even Adam and Eve. After heaven, the next purest place that God made was the Garden of Eden. He created Adam and Eve pure. And what happened? Satan fed lies to them too, and he converted them too. And they all sin. Instead of love, joy, and peace, he brought in hatred, discord, and rage. Okay. Likewise, we should also never forget, never underestimate the power of love. Because of the power of love, God died for us. He loved us so much that he reconciled us to him. He brought unity. And he shunned evil and division, so that we can reach out and grab this handle that he has given to us, the cross. And in unity, we can unite and go closer to God. Okay? We need to be obedient. In obedience and in act of faith, we can get closer to us. We need to believe that God is going to be with us and he's going to help us overcome our unbeliefs. Okay? If we just remove the unbelief, a mustard seed amount of faith will be sufficient to move our problems. God said that we need to be obedient and we can overcome all of our unbeliefs when we do that. Win one for the Son from sin should be our goal. Win one. You know what Mahatma Gandhi said? My life is my message. And I think I could really literally end my sermon here. Let's become winners of Jesus with our life. Jesus told his disciples to preach good news to everyone, make disciples of all our nation, all nations. Matthew 4 talks about, come follow me, Jesus said, and I'll send you out to fish for people. And at once they left their nets and followed him. So God is telling us he's going to send us to places so that he can make disciples of others. How is he going to do that? With what we have to say and what we have to live, how we live our lives. We can be examples with our lives. We can be examples with what we say. Mark 16 talks about go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. God wants us to reflect his life in our his story with what we say and what we live. He wants his message reflected in our lives to other people so that we can convert people, to make them come and follow Jesus because they have seen the light in us and through us. I is also the center of win. Let's become winners of him. Okay? It is very easy to defeat someone, but it is very hard to win someone. Dr. Abdul Kalam Azad, he is an intellect, a nuclear scientist, an Indian president, Dr. Abdul Kalam Azad, said he was the most humblest man. He said, it's easy to defeat somebody. It's easy to be mean to your friends who have hurt you. It's easy to hurt somebody. It's easy to make them, put them in place, show them what you are worth. It's easy to defeat somebody, but it's so hard to win that same person that who has been mean to you. Let's all become winners for Christ. Let's all learn to win people to him with our lives. From I to O, from sin to the Son. From I to O, from sin to Son. Let's look at this glow stick. Lessons from a glow stick. Okay. Has everybody ever had a glow stick? Has anybody seen a glow stick? Okay. Let's look at this glow stick. Can everybody see this? Okay.
Yes.
I'm going to play a video. Okay. And then I'll show you what happens with this glow stick. Let me play the video manually. Probably it's not.
Hey guys, good morning. Hope you all are doing well. Hope you had a good week. A couple of days back, I was reading something and it was so simple and yet it was such a powerful reminder and I thought of sharing that with you. You know, in life, there's some people who walk and then there's some people who run. But just remember, God gave the tortoise and the horse the same number of days to reach Noah's ark. So in life, there'll be challenges, there'll be ups, there'll be downs, but be rest assured, you will reach your destination. You know, Jacob saw in Joseph a fine son. The 10 brothers saw in Joseph a useless beamer. The traveler saw in Joseph a slave. And Potiphar saw in Joseph a fine servant. Potiphar's wife saw in Joseph a potential boyfriend. And the prison guards saw in Joseph a prisoner. But you know what? Every single one of them was wrong. Because God saw in Joseph a potential prime minister of Egypt in the waiting. So I want to say this to you guys. Be encouraged by what God sees in you. It does not matter what people see in you. What matters is what God sees in you. So there are a couple of one-liners that I absolutely love, and I have to share it with you, and this is how it goes. It does not matter what your age is, that's why he chose Abraham. It does not matter what your experience is, that's why he chose David. It does not matter what your past is, that's why he called Paul. It does not matter what your gender is, that's why he lifted Esther. It does not matter what your appearance is, that's why he chose Zacchaeus, the shortest one. It does not matter your fluency of speech, that's why he chose Moses. It does not matter what your career is, that's why he chose Mary Magdalene. So I just want to remind you that God sees great things in you. And I just want to encourage you with that. The best is yet to come. Have a great week, guys.
Okay, lessons from a glow stick. Let's look at this glow stick, okay? This is like the I that we talk about. God is here and we are here, okay? How can we meet God? You know what God does? He bends us in many ways with our daily experiences, things that happen around us. And you see what happens when he bends us, that section starts glowing. And he keeps bending. Every edge has to be bent because we're so straight. Okay? When we live in the fruit of I, God starts bending us. And you know what? When he bends, we make a big O. And see, how do we keep it together? There is a connector. Okay? What is that connector? That's the Holy Spirit. We all need the connector in our life. That is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our connection. And that's when we glow in Christ. When we overcome our eyes and we start living in the fruits of the Holy Spirit, the O in the Holy Spirit, we are become whole. Has everybody read Steps to Christ? I'm sure everybody has read the books. There are 13 steps in Steps to Christ. Okay. God's love for us. He created us. The sinner's need for Christ. Repentance, confession, consecration, faith, and abundance. There are 13 steps. The next steps are discipleship. That is the fruits of spirit. The work of growing up in Christ. A knowledge of God. The privilege of prayer, what do we do in doubt? Rejoice in love. And it's a beautiful book. And if anybody needs a book, please let us know. And we can definitely mail you, whatever. Let me know. Let Jeffrey know, Pastor Jeffrey know, and anybody else, you know. Anand, Mr. Anand, let anybody know. And we will send you, mail you, send us your mailing address. And we'll send you the 13 Steps to Christ, the book by Mrs. Ellen White. This is a different, from a different sermon. This whole thing is a whole sermon, but I'm just going to share it with you real. All the steps to Christ literally reflects the tabernacle. The 13 steps of this beautiful tabernacle. Step one and two, God's love for us. That's when God sacrificed, right? And then we have our need for Jesus, number two. We accept Jesus' sacrifice and then we step into the next stage. That is a lever where we wash. We repentance, confession. When we get baptized, when we do foot washing, all this is here. And I remember, I don't know if I talked to you this group, but I talked another sermon about how water being the divinity, the divine water. And when we wash ourselves with this divine water, we get into the holy place. Steps 5, 6, and 10 is about the table of showbread, where we submit ourselves on a daily basis by reading his word every day, acknowledging him. Step 7, 8, and 9 is about his works, how we grow in Christ, how we gain and reflect his character. And step 11 and 12 is about prayer, how we pray every day and trust that God is there and he exists and that we're going to go to heaven. And step 13 is when we rejoice in heaven. It's a beautiful thing that God did for all of us. Such a fantastic thing. The walk that reflects the 13 steps to Christ. Finally, growing, glowing in Jesus. Let's step away from the fruit of I and step into the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the O of the Holy Spirit. I want to say to you, John 12:35 says, my brothers, I would say to you, be careful. Go not one step further in the path you have entered upon, but walk in the light while you still have the light, lest darkness comes upon you. Praise God. We need to walk in this light that God has given us. We all need to read this book, Steps to Christ by E.G. White. Please definitely let us know if you haven't read it. It's such a wonderful book. We all need to win one for the Son by stepping away from sin and into him every day. And may this message reflect in everybody's life today, that we all need to step aside from the eyes and embrace the O of the Holy Spirit. Embrace the good eyes. Eyes where we win souls for Jesus in unity. And bring people in unity towards God. And stop creating confusion and division in churches with what we say and do. But living and loving God every day and reflecting the right things that only share heaven and share the good things about heaven, so that one day when we go to heaven, we'll see all the winners that we have won for Jesus and not created division and lost souls for Jesus. Let's all become winners today. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Suhana. You really demonstrated yourself. You could be, you are a very good teacher for the children. And I'm telling you, I too did enjoy every step that you've been able to walk forward. And I know that how children would love to listen to you in this regard. May God use you and your talents to glorify your name, or go to glorify his name, wherever you might be able to be led by his Spirit. And we want to wholeheartedly, HopeSide Church, want to thank you for being a part of us and being able to give us this beautiful message in each one of us. Thank you once again. To conclude, let's all join and sing hymn number 570 from SDA, hymnal 570, not I, but Christ. Let's all join 570, not I, but Christ. After the closing song, I request Dr. Suhana to please to close with a benediction.
Let's pray. Our Father, thank you so much for this beautiful Sabbath day that you've given to us, Lord. Thank you so much that this week ends with this beautiful day, Lord, where we can come to you and worship you and honor you and praise you and remind ourselves that it's you, it's all about you, Lord, nothing about us, Lord, helping us to know that you are the greatest God, Lord. You are the one that we need to look up to. You have done everything for us. Nothing is ours, Lord. Nothing is ours, nor our money, nor our things that you have given to us, Lord. It's all yours, Lord. Everything is yours. And we just need to give you glory every day, Lord. We need to lead our children, our families, and our friends, and our church members to you, Lord. Help us to avoid looking at ourselves, but look at you every day. Help us to stop being negativity, but to inspire people to love you. Be the best message, our lives, to reflect you in our lives with our things that we say and do. Lord, help us every day to come closer to you, draw near to you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. You are the best God ever. We don't know how we can bring people to you, but you have given us the Holy Spirit, Lord, who is going to work in our hearts so we can be better examples daily, Lord. Thank you so much for this blessing, Lord. There are so many people in pain, so many people in suffering, Lord, so many people who need help, who have health issues. Some people have physical, mental, spiritual issues, Lord. Please reach out to them, Lord. Please find them angels, special, send Holy Spirit through other people to them, who can talk to them and encourage them and help them to know the beautiful pearly gates, the beautiful heaven that we all are waiting to go to, Lord. Please help everybody, each one, encourage each other in many different ways so that we all can have our mission to go to heaven straightened out, Lord, so that we don't focus on ourselves, but to God every day, Lord. Help us to focus on you. Keep helping us, coming closer to you on a daily basis, loving you, honoring you, and praising you every day, dear Jesus. You're the best God ever. Amen, Lord. Thank you so much. Amen. Every day, Lord, you are the greatest God. Amen.
Thank you for that benediction and the message. And I want to thank each one of you who could be able to join us in Zoom and in the YouTube. And I hope that we all enjoyed on this Sabbath. And may God be with you. Remember that we are praying for you. You need any help of prayer, Bible study, anything that we can do, please to call us or mail us. We'll be very happy to serve you to the best of our ability. Of course, keep yourself safe. Be happy, keep in prayers, and may this week be a joyful and a blessed week for each one of you till we meet again. Thank you once again for joining with us, and God be with you all. Maranatha, Jesus is coming.